All right. So for everybody that's here tonight, I know we're starting with a bit of a lower number, and I'm sure people are going to make their way in. It's a Sunday night. It's busy. First off, to everybody watching, I just want to introduce myself. My name is Tennille LaFontaine. I am not a teacher. I'm a mom of three. I live in Regina. I've got three kids. They are 16, 12, and 9. That means I've got a high schooler, a seventh grader, and a fourth grade child this year, all going to school. So my interest in Safe School Saskatchewan is clear, and why I'm a part of this group and why I'm speaking out and hosting and being the voice for this chat. And with us tonight, we have Ryan Meili, who is the leader of the NDP party here in Saskatchewan, the official opposition. We did put forth the invitation to Scott Moe, our premier of the Sask party. His office declined. So we want to make that clear from the beginning. We do want to make sure that we give everybody equal voice in this discussion. We did put that invitation forward. Here we are. But I'm so thankful that we do have Mr. Meili here tonight to answer questions. And the way that these questions have come to us is from the Safe Schools Saskatchewan Facebook page. We put it out to our members, I guess you would say, are people that are in our community who have put forth their questions to us to ask our leaders. So that is you, Ryan, that you're going to get the majority of these questions tonight. And I've got about a dozen for you. So we're just going to get started and jump in. For everybody that is watching and listening, this is being recorded, so you'll be able to watch it on YouTube later and get all the answers that you need. So Ryan, this is the first time you and I have seen each other face to face and had time to chat. So I couldn't even name how many kids you have at this point. So why don't you jump in and tell us about you? I mean, I know what you do for a job, but tell me about your family and how many kids you have.
Great. Well, maybe just before that, Tennille, and thank you for that question. I think it's really important that we remember we're all coming at this from different places, different roles in life, but it's our family connections and connections to our neighborhoods and communities that really remind us how important this is. And when we think about trying to protect the province as a whole from COVID-19, you know, you put a face on that, and it just becomes all that more real. I want to thank you and thank all of the folks from Safe School Saskatchewan, everybody who's been doing incredible advocacy. You've already moved the dial on this. You know, we had a plan in June that was empty, similar, basically the same plan in July. And because of the pressure that you've put on, there are more dollars in the system now. Because of the pressure you've put on, the school divisions have been able to elaborate plans. There's still big pieces that are missing, still things that need to be done that haven't yet, but we have a much better chance going into classrooms next week of keeping people safe and preventing the spread of COVID-19 than we did if you folks hadn't stepped up and done the incredible advocacy. That to me is extremely important. So just to answer the personal question though, I live here in Saskatoon. I'm married to Meili Brindamore, who is a pediatrician, and we have two little boys. Abraham, Abe is 9, just turned 9 last week. And on Friday, Gus, the little one, will turn 3. So a 9 and a 3-year-old. And so Abe is going back into school, going into grade 4. And he's very excited to get to school, get to see his friends. He did fine with online learning, but it was okay. But it's really, I don't think anybody would say that it's a better experience or anywhere near the experience that is what schools can offer. And that's why, you know, for me personally, that's like my daily reminder of why this is so important. But it is so important that we get this right. So important that we get this right to keep kids safe, to keep our numbers down so that we don't see lots more infections. For a second, and to protect our economy as well. You know, if we're going to be successful in continuing to keep what's open and reopen further, that means keeping the numbers low and getting the school reopening wrong is very dangerous.
That's what we're working towards, right? This is what we've been doing for, I was going to say weeks, but I think it's been, we're past a month at this point that this group has been growing and trying to get people to listen and hear these concerns. So we'll start with our first question. And this came from a member of the Safe School Saskatchewan community. Her name's Amanda. Ryan, she says, how should the provincial government spend the $75 million they've been given by the federal government? I know that's a big question, but how should that money be spent?
So there's a little bit of background required, but I guess the big thing that I would say is the government should be spending whatever money they're able to on reducing class sizes. That was a problem before COVID-19. We have way too many classes with 30 plus kids, not to mention, you know, we've got more kids in each class, but also more kids special needs, more kids for whom English or French is a new language, more kids coming to school dealing with anxiety, more kids coming to school hungry. So more complex, more crowded classrooms. Before COVID-19, that was a problem that needed to be addressed then. Now you add the challenge of physical distancing and the need to keep people separate in that way to prevent COVID-19, it's absolutely an emergency. Now, there are some limitations on how they can spend that $75 million. It's worth noting that the province is getting 37.5 up front, and they get the other 37.5 if they spend that first half within the criteria that the federal government has set out. And there are some limitations there. It's largely not to be used for staff, for hiring, for operations. It's more for things like adapting learning spaces, improving ventilation. Maybe there would be some options to use it for renting space, which is one of the ways that we could use those dollars to decrease class sizes. It's more things like PPE goods rather than operations and hiring. That said, those dollars can be used to offset costs, offset dollars in the provincial budget that were already dedicated to those goods, to those tangible purchasables. And those dollars from within the provincial budget can now be shifted towards more hiring and other things that can be done to decrease class sizes and increase the supports available for students. So that's what I would say is, let's do that. Every chance we get, let's use the resources available in a way that will allow us to reduce class sizes.
Okay, and I think it's important to note that you did point out that we are only getting 50% now at this point, and the other half will depend on how that first half is utilized.
Yeah, and so hopefully we do get that second half. Hopefully the province uses the money properly. It is not, you know, this is a province that has left money on the table before, a government that's left money on the table before in federal matching dollars for other programs. Hopefully we won't see that happen. And, you know, hopefully we won't see, if the second half comes in, them just use it to backfill their deficit, which is often, you know, if dollars are not earmarked, often we've seen this government just use it to backfill their other spending decisions rather than what those dollars are meant for. And in this case, I would be very upset to see any money going outside of education from the $75 million that are to be coming in.
Right. Wow. That's interesting to note. And I think that's very important too. And I can't think of any parent that I've spoken to that would want any of that money left on the table in this school year that we're going into. That would be weird to actually have that considered, but it's interesting you brought that up. We're going to shift a little bit. We're going back into the classroom. This question comes from Lee, Mr. Meili, and the question is, my biggest concern is aerosol transmission in the classroom. How do I know if the ventilation in the school is good enough?
Yeah, and I know we have Dr. Huang on the line as well, and she might have something to add here. She's been I have to say, Anne Huang has done an incredible job as well as an advocate through all of this. She was the first person in public health to speak out against the idea of a snap election in the spring, which would have been just a terrible idea in the middle of the beginning of a pandemic to have people going door to door and shaking hands and holding rallies, but that was going to happen. And she spoke out on that, and she's spoken out. She was one of the first people to speak about the need for masks, you know, long time ahead of even some of the leadership around the country talking about the importance of masks. So kudos to Anne, and I know she'll have some things to add when it comes to ventilation. And as far as we know, aerosol transmission is something that would be a concern within the classroom, but not likely a concern sort of spreading through ducts from one classroom to another.
Okay.
Whenever we have these discussions, the science is developing, that understanding could change, but that's, as far as we know, that's the case. So that also means that the system ventilation matters, but it's probably more at the individual classroom level that the questions are most important to be asked. But you do need to make sure that you've got a system that is that doesn't result, that isn't needing additional repairs, that isn't broken, that your overall system for the school is still working well, is still really important. And one of the things that concerns me is that every year school divisions come forward with their requests for repairs. That wish list goes to the Ministry of Education, that then goes on to SASC Builds. Funny thing is that the Minister of Education, who is Gordon Wyant, and you all know he's got that job, he also has the job of being Minister for SASC Builds. So he is the one who would have seen from every school division the HVAC repairs that are needed, and would have been making the decisions on which ones of those got funded in recent years. So one of the things I think we should be doing, as well as folks asking their principals and their school divisions what the state of HVAC is in their schools, we also should be asking Mr. Wyant for a very clear description of which school divisions and which schools have asked for those repairs, and demanding a real accounting of where those flaws are and what action is going to be taken to address them.
I'm waiting for Dr. Huang as well. If our other moderators do see her pop in, please turn her video on so that we'll jump back to her and get her questions.
Hey. iPad, so she is there.
Hi, sorry, I don't have my video on.
Okay, well, we can hear you. That's good. You heard the discussion thus far on the aerosol transmission, so I'd love for you to jump in at this point if you'd like to add more.
Sure. Yeah, I'll just add briefly. I think the question was how do you know that you have adequate ventilation in school? And I think there are two ways of looking at it. And I'm not an engineer, take what I say with a grain of salt. And so, if anyone is in connection with experts in this field, I think it'd be great to hear from them publicly on this. But one of the way to estimate it is to approximate crowdedness by measuring the concentration of carbon dioxide in a room. So we know we will exhale a certain amount of carbon dioxide when we breathe, and there have been studies that show correlation, which makes sense, between the concentration of carbon dioxide in a room and crowdedness. And so that's one way of gauging whether the too many people in the room. But another way, a better way maybe, to calculate the amount of fresh, more specifically, the amount of clean air required per second per person. And I've heard a value mentioned, and I know when I was attending the U.S. Academy of the National Academy of Science, Engineering, and Medicine, they held a two-day virtual workshop just this past week. I heard from the Hong Kong professor who was involved in the original SARS outbreak, when they had an outbreak in a high-rise apartment. He talked about how they've began to post these COVID room capacity on every sort of the door of the classroom or any public shared space. And he did mention a figure of, you know, how many liter of clean air delivery per second per person in the room. But I I have not been able to personally verify that to be correct. And so I don't want to put it out and come, you know, and sort of cause any further confusion.
Sure.
But that's, there's sort of, these are the sort of the two measures that we could sort of ensure that the ventilation, or more specifically, the clean air delivered to each space is adequate.
Maybe I just have one quick
go ahead.
There. There's going to be a lot of technical differences, even school to school, as we try to address this. And I've been chatting with folks like Anne in public health, but also engineers who are involved in ventilation. And there's a lot of really complex concepts here. And one of the things that I would just emphasize is, we can do our best guess from the outside, but really what we need is a government that's willing to acknowledge that ventilation is important and that is actually going to work with experts in the field to come up with a plan that keeps people safe. And you know, it's a commentary on the weaknesses of the plan so far that we're having to have these sort of side discussions instead of getting some really clear information from the province on what the evidence says is going to work the best. And that's, you know, if I was in the position of premier, if we were able to form government, I would be making sure that the experts were at the table from the beginning and that we were communicating this clearly instead of leaving so much to the guesswork of folks who are on the outside of those decision-making tables.
Speaking of being unclear, here's a question that came in from the chat. This one's to you, Dr. Meili, Mr. Meili. Dr. Shahab has said that only kids who sit within 2 meters of an infected child, should this happen, will this happen at school, will need to self-isolate. As a doctor, do you agree with that assessment?
Well, thanks, Tanil. I don't know exactly what Dr. Shahab said. I hadn't heard exactly the quote there, but I would be concerned with that assessment. You're in a situation where we know that this virus travels more than 2 meters. We know the understanding of the transmission has changed. We also know that kids do move around. This idea, we've been hearing this idea that kids will just stay facing forward. First of all, I'm an adult and I won't stay facing forward for an hour.
We both have 9-year-olds. We know that these 9-year-olds are not going to face forward, right?
Well, we'll be looking around. They'll be looking around. They'll be talking to their neighbors. It's just not going to happen, for one. So that whole thing, as long as kids are facing forward, it's not an issue. It's just, it makes no sense to me. But yes, I would be more concerned than what I understand that quote to say about kids in the entire room and the teacher, not only those within a small perimeter around the kid.
Right. And I think that echoes what we're hearing from parents everywhere. That's the concern that we're hearing, that it just doesn't make sense that if a child tests positive in a classroom, that only a certain amount of kids in that area would need to be of concern. Go ahead.
Themselves are vectors, right? So
yeah,
maybe the kid who we know has tested positive is on the other side of the room, but there's a whole bunch of kids that can be the trampoline bouncing that virus across the room as they've caught it from them. It just doesn't really add up to say that limited space would be all you'd need to worry about.
Okay, that leads into our next question. It comes from Andre, back to the classroom and the school. What are the most effective measures that schools should be employing to prevent the spread of COVID-19?
So the two most obvious ones to me are class sizes and masks. And class sizes is a huge one, and I know it's challenging. It's not something that you can just snap your fingers and change. But I keep coming back to this question that a reporter asked Mr. Wyatt when he outlined the second, or maybe it was the third version of this plan. But she said to him, "So basically you're saying this was hard, so you decided not to try." And that's not good enough. We need to try. We need to be thinking about how we use our existing space differently, what other spaces are available. And you've got university classrooms, you've got churches, you've got some office spaces that aren't being used. What could we do to expand our size And also, what can we do to take advantage of this moment to make some of the investments that were necessary beforehand to decrease class sizes and get that right now? Use this as an opportunity to make the changes we already need. The other thing is masks. It's really, when we talk about air passing between people, one of the easiest ways to prevent that happening is to have not a HEPA filter somewhere off in elsewhere in the building, but that filter right in front of you. And I know, Tennille, you've been...
Me?
What is it? Hashtag wear a damn mask.
Wear a damn mask.
So you've been a pretty strong advocate on this, and it makes sense. You know, they really do work. And it took time for the evidence to develop enough that we understood that, but there is no question anymore. And it was back in, I know Anne was advocating for masks back in March. It was back in April when I came out and said we needed to use masks, and months later before the premier was willing to start recommending that. And they've been very reluctant and very unclear when it comes to what's expected in schools, leaving it up to individual divisions and even often individual schools and classrooms to figure out what they will do. We need a consistent approach, consistent description of what the phases are, and clear guidance on how and when to use masks.
I love that. I really like the quote from the reporter that you mentioned, because it was hard, it sounds like you didn't even try. And that takes us back to parents and our kids. I mean, is that not what we talk about all the time with our kids? Just because something is difficult and feels insurmountable and feels really, really big, that doesn't mean that you don't try. And I think that's where a lot of parents are feeling that frustration, is that we're putting our kids back in this learning environment and we're telling them that they need to work hard. And we need that from our leaders right now, going back to school. Which takes us to our next question. This is from Anonymous, and I'm gonna touch on this quickly and why these questions are anonymous. And that goes back to the Safe School Saskatchewan. We have a large community of a lot of teachers, and they may not feel as comfortable coming forward with their questions, which is concerning to me as a parent that they're not, but I understand why. So we have some anonymous questions. This one, it goes back to Dr. Shahab again. A couple of weeks ago, Dr. Shahab said that large urban high schools are, or had the option to, go to that level 3 opening. So why are high schools in Saskatoon and Regina operating at level 2 with no reduction in instructional hours? Why can divisions reduce the safety standards that have been recommended by public health?
And what is strange about the whole approach to this? Now, we talked about phases. We put out a bit of a 7-point plan, and I'll maybe throw that in the chat box here in a second. Earlier on, before the government came out with versions 2, 3, and 4 of their plan, talking about what would actually be needed. And one of the clear things that we outlined was the importance of phases. And that means, you know, you're a school at phase 1, you're doing very little from different school at phase 2, doing more. Phase 3, maybe you've got staggered classes or reduced hours, instructional hours, as is described. That's something that the government was reluctant to bring in, eventually did, but one of the things that's missing is any indication of when those kick in. And to me, if you're trying to be scientifically minded about this, you would say, okay, phase 2 is when you have X number of cases per 100,000 in the community, or your R0, the rate of transmission of cases from you know, the number of people who would be infected from an original case is over a certain number. These are the kind of things that should be guiding. But instead, what the government has said basically is school divisions should decide what phase they're at. And so even this question, when you have that quote that large urban high schools have the option to go with level 3, it's still an option. It's right. Still, give us your best guess. And what just drives me crazy about this is the school divisions have been cut to the bone for years and years. Their resources are so much less. But even at the best of times, they never had public health departments. And they are not in a position to be making the decisions of what phase they're in. They should be, we should have consistent standards of what happens in phase 1, 2, and 3, and consistent direction from the government. So a school doesn't decide, or a division doesn't decide what phase they're in the government comes and says, you're in phase three because this is what's happening from an epidemiological, so viral transmission point of view. And that's one thing that would be, you would see drastically different from me if I was in the position to be leading this, is I would be making sure that people understood what's determining what phases we're in and having a consistent set of conditions that happen in each of the phases.
And we're hearing that a lot too, that consistency or inconsistency, and we're finding that across every discussion, it seems to be, in terms of going back to school, that because we've diverted that over to the school boards, there is no consistency. And that for people that visit the Facebook group, Safe Schools Saskatchewan, you'll find that we have so many parents coming on and going, this is what we're doing in this division, what's happening in yours? Or this is, why are they doing it this way in Prince Albert and they're not doing it this way in Swift Current? So it's frustrating for parents as well, not to have that consistency. A question that's come up, and we're on our fifth question right now, and I've wrestled with it myself too, because people are always debating it. Dr. Huang, if you're around still, I think you are, you can jump in here, but it's this question we keep hearing. Is COVID-19 airborne or not?
And I think this one would be a good place for Anne to start and let us know how the science and evidence have been developing in our understanding of transmission.
Are you there, Anne?
Yes, sure. So the question was, is COVID-19, more specifically, the SARS coronavirus 2, can it be transmitted through the air? The answer is yes, in the sense that you can breathe in this virus by breathing in air that contains the virus, and that's how you become infected. The reason public health and medical communities and WHO has yet to clearly come out and say it's an airborne virus has to do with how traditionally the infection prevention control and medical professionals have defined airborne transmission. And their definition of airborne transmission is quite specific to how measles virus is transmitted, meaning that it could travel a long distance in the air and linger for multiple hours. So the COVID-19 virus can do the same. And the evidence so far has suggested that it could travel more than 6 feet away. I commented on this for CBC the national CBC News article, because the new preprint study that showed that even in the hospital setting with great ventilation and filtration, the symptomatic COVID-19 patient, was releasing viruses that are carried in these tiny fluid bubbles or particles, however you want to call them. And the proper term by the scientist and engineer who studied them is aerosols, actually. And so they found that in 7 to 13 feet away from the head of the patient, and they were able to culture that virus, and then that virus was shown to be capable of infecting cell lines in the lab. Now, they have not demonstrated that virus from the air sample could infect human, but there's enough mechanistic evidence, from what they are able to show. So peace has been building up. And so to be frank, and I'm comfortable in saying this publicly, the current definition of what consist of airborne transmission that's been used by the medical public health community and that's still being kind of used by WHO is actually not supported by empiric scientific evidence. So when they do the actual measurement, we actually release mostly small micro droplets called aerosols. And those are actually the ones that could contain the COVID-19 virus. So and that's important to recognize, because that's why face masks are effective. even though the COVID-19 virus is only 0.12 micron in diameter, they don't travel naked through the air. They are released from an infectious person in their respiratory secretion in generally, aerosol or fluid bubble that's at least 1 micron, in diameter, so at least 10 times the size of the virus. And then once the fluid is dried up, that's how then the virus can sort of linger in the air, depending on the relative humidity and the temperature in the environment. And then if you're in the vicinity, so particularly if you're within 1 meter of the person who's speaking, not even coughing, sneezing, because when you cough and sneeze, it's a larger droplet that you're seeing. But when you're just talking, you're actually releasing 99% of the time, it's those smaller aerosols. So you can breathe it in. And that's why, we've heard about people losing the sensation of smell, because we have receptors in our nose, nasal cavity, ACE2 receptor that the COVID-19 virus used to dock onto the cell and then get into, our body to infect. So I think it's airborne in the sense, as we understand it, sort of the language that we would use it in English, that yes, it travels through the air, and more precisely, it's inhalation transmission, like you could breathe it in. Whereas when they talk about droplet, large droplet transmission, it's referring to the larger respiratory droplets landing directly on your eyes, nose, or mouth. And that's why then the physical distancing help, because then you're less likely to be spit on, essentially. Mm-hmm. But mask can protect you from both the larger droplets and the smaller micro droplets. So I think that's part of the reason why we are having such difficulty conveying, some of the important public health intervention measures at this time. But I think eventually we'll hear that corrected. And I just want to add, because I wanted to make sure, if I'm saying something publicly, I could back it up, because and so I was relieved, because again, it was the 2-day virtual workshop on airborne transmission of the SARS coronavirus 2, the virus that caused COVID-19 2, that I attended just this week, organized by the U.S. National Academy of Science, Engineering, and Medicine. And that was unanimous unified response. And the direct implication is that because it could linger in air, and that's why physical distancing on its own in a poorly ventilated room or space will not be adequate if there's enough of the concentration of virus. If there's only a little bit, of course, then the risk would be lower, because it's all related to the amount and the duration of exposure. And so that concept of you being able to breathe in the virus has important implication for our prevention and control strategy. And I imagine we'll be hearing that update soon enough, because even Dr. Anthony Fauci sort of provided an opening remark for this workshop. I mean, he didn't weigh in on this issue, but there might be a convergence that we'll hear from WHO soon, I hope, okay, on this. Yeah. Sorry for the long explanation, but that's a really important one.
No, but it's an explanation that I can understand, and that's important too, because if you speak it in a way that regular folk like me can understand and make sense of it, that helps, and I appreciate that. On that note, I do have a question for you that came from our chat, Dr. Huang. One of our teachers in the chat would like to know the best place to put a portable HEPA filter, close to the air exchange vents, heater vents, or somewhere else closer to the students. Where would you put it in a classroom?
Again, take my answer with a caveat. What I've read is probably in the center, assuming the room has good mixing of the air, because of the distance, because you want to ensure that you can filter as much as you can of the air. And so you want to place it in a place where the return and the sort of the whole movement of it. But again, this is why I, you know, there needs to be some sort of technical guidance, I think, from people that are familiar with indoor air quality to provide that guidance, because depending on where the participant have mentioned, depending on the vent, depending on where the return air and versus the heating source, because there's different air current movement, and that's totally beyond my expertise to answer. And so I think like what Ryan mentioned, like it would be important to have some of that money spent on getting expert sort of recommendation in this area. And so the school divisions are not left to figure this out from various HVAC professionals who may or may not be familiar with the transmission of respiratory viruses.
Okay. I'm going to jump ahead one question here, just because we've talked about aerosols and we've talked about droplets and we're talking about being in a classroom. A lot of parents and teachers are wondering, is COVID-19 transferable on paper?
So generally the thought is that that's one of the least likely surfaces to transmit. Looking at the amount of time that a virus stays alive on different surfaces, that's paper is one of the least successful places for the virus to live. I may have more to add, but in general, paper is not one of the things you need to be the most concerned about.
I agree with that.
Good. Something encouraging here. This is good.
Yeah, absolutely.
Anything else to add?
No, I think it's really important. The one of the things I think it's important to remember, all of the sanitizing, that's all good stuff and certainly not knocking that at all. But sometimes I think it ends up being pointed as something tangible that we can see and that we can do, and maybe even a substitute for addressing some of the other more difficult things, more controversial like mask use or more challenging like reducing class sizes. So while we're all fine with the sanitizing, please do that. It's also really important that we not take that as, oh, okay, well, we're doing this, so we're good.
That makes sense. I'm going to jump into another question. I love this, how my questions are moving around based on the answers. But this question comes from Mark in our group. He wanted to know, what will your after-school home protocols be? Should we be stripping the kids at the door and telling them to go shower as soon as they walk in from school? Do we need to be spraying down their backpacks every day? What are we as parents looking at here?
That's a good question and something we've wrestled with both my wife and I have been practicing medicine through this time. I was back at the COVID testing site and doing clinics at the Lighthouse. She's a pediatrician, so she's in the hospital as well as clinic. And so we have a pretty strict routine when we're coming back from clinical, scrubs in the laundry, have your shower before you're touching anything or hugging people, hello. That's going to be really challenging for kids. I think it's tough to put that on them. Every family is going to sort of figure out their comfort level, but I would say at the very least, you want to make sure that kids do, when they get home, wash their hands really thoroughly and like up to the elbows and do that good hand wash, and probably a good idea to change clothes and throw the clothes from the day in the laundry. I don't think you need to worry as much about disinfecting backpacks, etc. But again, this is stuff that we should be getting some guidelines from the folks with evidence and asking for some clarity from the government. And maybe you've got some more to add and more to teach me as well on the best approach here. But once again, there's so many things here and this is where I think a lot of the frustration is coming from. There are obvious questions for parents to ask, obvious questions for teachers to ask, and yet complete silence when it comes from the folks who actually have the resources to give us the direction.
And I should note that on that, we're getting questions from teachers. They're asking the same thing in the chat. Can you follow up and ask if teachers should be showering and changing when they get home from school every day? I think that that only makes good sense if we're asking that of our kids. That's something that teachers are going to have to endure daily as well.
Yeah, and again, it also depends who's at home. If you've got folks in your world that are immune-compromised, seniors, others that are at higher risk, or just you have no choice but to interact with multiple people who could then be interacting with other folks at risk, that's part of the consideration. We opened up our bubble, so to speak, over the summer and had my boys going to visit grandma and grandpa in Moose Jaw and spend time there. We're going to pull back from that for a while now that Abe's in school and, you know, wait and see what happens before we have any more visits with grandparents. My mom's got COPD. I certainly don't want to be exposing her to COVID-19. And so we're going to be extra careful.
Right. And we're hearing a lot of that too, that family visits with extended family are going to come to an end if they haven't already very soon because of kids being back in school and the risk that it will bring to extended family members like grandparents. On that note too, when are people most contagious, Mr. Meili? I've heard it, this is from Sandra. I've heard it is before they're symptomatic. So when they're asymptomatic is when she's hearing they're the most contagious. I've also read that viral load in kids can be higher than in adults. Is this true?
And so the timing of highest viral load and is worth some discussion, and Anne may have more to say on that as well. And yes, I've been reading some of the same questions about viral load in kids perhaps being higher. I would say it's really unlikely that you're more, even if you're shedding more virus, which means your body is sort of moving through the virus, there's more in your spit and your snot and your other fluids. I doubt very much that you would be more likely to pass on the virus before you have symptoms, because the symptoms are the trajectory, right? Coughing, sneezing, those are the things that make those fluids go and attach themselves to others. So it is when you can have asymptomatic transmission, but certainly people are at higher risk of passing on the virus if they are symptomatic. One of the things, and maybe we'll discuss this later as well, but one of the reasons that people are concerned about the months ahead is that it's not just COVID-19, but it's all of the other colds and flus that happen in the winter time that mean that people are coughing and sneezing and runny noses a lot more. And that means if that was the case, you've got higher viral load. Maybe you're asymptomatic from COVID-19. You've got another cold or cough. It's kind of the hitchhiker theory that you could have the virus catching a ride with other colds and being passed on. That's part of why there's so much concern about a second wave coming up. And anything you want to add around the viral load and transmission?
I have to say I am not as up to date about pediatric transmission, but what I think has become clear, Ryan, you alluded to it, is that we've got lots more data now about young children. And so I don't think it's correct to assume that young children don't transmit the virus, as I think had assumed earlier on about the safety of just having young children come back to schools mixed as they would pre-pandemic. But the question of whether it's more or not, I think that's being figured out for sure. But I think it's clear, like teenagers or older students, they behave more like adults in terms of the susceptibility to become infected and transmit, although they do not so far seem to get as ill as older adults, probably because in general, younger people, you know, I'm talking about like, say, the teens, 12 to 18, are generally healthier. They don't have the comorbidity that increase your risk of the severeness of COVID-19. Yeah.
That's one of the things we've heard from the government. They've said, oh, well, we didn't have any problems with daycare in the summer, so things should be fine in schools. daycares are different. You don't have 30 plus kids in a small space for hours on end. You also, we had very low community transmission. And hopefully, you know, we're seeing it drop again after the most recent spike. Hopefully that'll continue. But you just cannot be confident with what we know about the fact that kids transmit to point backwards at a very different situation and apply that to the weeks ahead.
With what we know, and there's so much that we don't know. So being overly confident going into school, I think, with anything right now is not a smart move. We have another question from the chat that popped up. Anonymous teacher would like to know, when we're talking about this money that hopefully is coming towards school, would engineered controls like plexiglass help reduce transmission in these crowded classrooms?
And I think there's definitely some potential for that to be useful. We've seen that used in other parts of the world. And even here at home, I think it's Pasqua and Cowessess First Nations are both doing some work to use plexiglass within the classroom. Again, these are some of the things that need to be explored as we try to create spaces where, between ventilation, decreasing the number of people, and physical barriers, whether those are physical barriers that are standalone or the physical barriers on your face, using this combination of methods to decrease the risk of transmission is absolutely worth exploring.
We've touched on plexiglass in the last question. This one is from another anonymous member of the group. Teacher says, I have a class of 34 high school students and I cannot get them even 1 meter apart in the classroom. What else can I do to keep myself and my students safe?
What a frustrating reality, right? To just be told, this is what we want you to do. We expect you to keep people apart. We expect you to keep safe, but here's the reality. Your situation just doesn't allow it. And that's really unfair. And I understand why so many teachers are asking the question of whether it is safe to be in that space. Practically, what are the things you can do? You know, we've heard a lot about them already today. Having mask use be happening in the classroom, in the hallways for sure, and as an option in classrooms, and you know, certainly allowing students to do that and making choices yourself about how to do that. We can look at different kinds of masks. You're starting to see more of the see-through masks, or even like lower face shields, different models that can be used that still allow people to see your face. So that's often very important for students. Thinking about, I know we've had already comments about HEPA filters and fans, asking for some guidance from your principal and your school division about what can work in your classroom. And it's a frustrating question to answer because I know you're already doing all of this.
It's a frustrating question to ask because we keep hearing it over and over and over. This is not one classroom. This is not one teacher. This is happening in classrooms across this province more commonly than the ability to have 2 meters of distance. So I'm hearing it over and over and over. And it's so frustrating as a parent, not even a teacher in the classroom, to hear this and to be alerted to it, and then to be told, well, this, you just need to have the 2 meters of distance and carry on.
Exactly. It's like being told there's water rushing into the house. What should you do? You can get a sump pump, you can learn to swim, but maybe the smart thing would be to turn off the water. And when it comes to this question, physical distancing is absolutely key. And the fact that we know that, we acknowledge it. It's the message that we have as our public health rules. You know, don't have gatherings over 30 people indoors anywhere, regardless of the size of the space. And yet we're saying to so many teachers, so many parents, here's a room where we're gonna cram people in and there's nothing you can do about it. It's just completely irresponsible.
Here is a question from Scott submitted to the page. And this is one that I can relate to because remember in the beginning I said I had a high school student and 2 elementary school students. So Scott asks, If my child's siblings come down with symptoms, should I keep their high school age brother home from school until they receive the test results? I'm concerned because if the SHA waits 48 hours from symptoms onset to test, then takes another couple of days to get those results under the QUINT program that's been introduced into the high schools this fall, that would result in a significant amount of classroom learning, far more than a normal schedule that's going to be lost. What do we do?
So this is a really specific question, but reveals a whole spectrum of problems. So one kid's got symptoms, do you keep every other kid home? One kid in a classroom has symptoms, does that classroom close down for a few days? Or a teacher has symptoms, does that mean every class that he or she has been in shouldn't be coming to school until they've all gotten tested? There's so many variations on this, not to mention then what happens in terms of those teachers staying home waiting for tests, or their subs to cover for them. How are subs being cohorted and supported to be safe? What's happening to, so it's my kid who's got symptoms. Well, am I staying home from work until I've been tested as well? There, what does that mean for all of the spillover from being diligent? And the fact of the matter is we don't really know. And we have not got any guidance whatsoever from the government. My gut feeling is, and my understanding from what I know of public health and epidemiology is, yeah, it's probably wise to get that kid tested too and have him or her stay home as well. As much of, as annoying as that is, it would be much worse if you were wrong and, you know, thought it was fine, but you've sent that kid now to infect their classmates and far more problems arise. But then how do we support, you know, talking about the QUINT model, how do we support that kid to get caught up with the missed learning? All of this comes back to the shocking lack of information and support and understanding of the realities that families and school staff are facing. And when you have a government that's just trying to say, we'll just try to make things as normal as possible, as though that would somehow decrease people's anxiety, what they fail to realize is things aren't normal. And so if you want to decrease people's anxiety, you give them the tools to deal with the new reality. You don't tell them to pretend that things were the way they were before. And this is where we've been really let down by Gord Wyatt, by Scott Moe, by their decision to give us as little information and as little guidance to respond to the new reality as possible.
And I will take that note to state, as a parent myself, so much of this has been diverted to the school divisions, right? They need to make the decisions and they need to figure it out. And August 26th was a big day when parents were getting all this information from the school divisions, and they are doing a phenomenal job with the information and the task that they've been given. And I am seeing from a lot of school divisions sending out info on how to talk to your kids about this. And I thought of that, Ryan, when you raised the point of, you know, going to school as normal as possible. Our kids know this is not a normal time right now, and we can't expect them to behave that way. We have to teach them what life is going to be like going forward. And I think that echoes a lot of parents' frustration when we heard that from our government, that we're going to go back to school as normal as possible. I'm going to ask you this question. It came from the chat, and I'm asking you because you know people. You know people, and maybe you could help out this member of the chat. John would like to know how we can contact Dr. Shahab, as he has no contact info listed. He'd like to raise concerns with him regarding his stance on distancing and who is that close contact in the classroom. I agree. I'm hearing from Dr. Shahab, but I can't ask him the questions that so many parents have.
So there, you can look up the information and call the office of the chief medical health officer. I'm not sure that's the best place to go. Just because really ultimately the decisions are coming from the government. We should be getting more guidance through the chief medical health officer's office, but it really is up to the leadership, the elected leadership, to make these decisions. And there's somebody whose name hasn't even come up today. And that's a person by the name of Jim Rader, who is the minister.
Where's he been?
The witness relocation program, for all I can tell. And he's completely missing in action. In the middle of a pandemic, we don't see the health minister.
Yep.
There's a minister of education, and there's a premier. And every one of those offices should have their phones ringing off the hook, because that's who actually is responsible, ultimately. That's who employs Dr. Shahab. And while his office is the office with the expertise, they are the people who have actually cut public health year after year for a decade. So made it harder for Dr. Shahab and all of his colleagues to do their work. And they're the ones who make the final decisions about which information gets shared. And it's them that made the choice to tell you everything's normal and to tell you as little information as they did. So that's where I'd be calling is Gord Wyatt, Jim Rader, Scott.
That was a great point. And I do want to leave us on that note. We've reached 9 o'clock and we've taken an hour of your time. And I want everybody watching and listening right now, again, to be reminded, Safe Schools Saskatchewan did put out the invite to Mr. Moe's office. We asked him to attend on a previous date, couldn't get a reply in time. We asked him to attend tonight, got the reply that he was unable to make it. We are trying to ask the questions. We are trying to get the answers. So we very much appreciate you coming, Mr. Meili, to speak with us and give us your insight, and Dr. Huang to jump in here when you have. Very much appreciated. On a last note, you said at the beginning that groups like Safe School Saskatchewan, parent council groups, teachers asking these questions are creating change. We're getting there slowly. What else can we do? What do we as parents and teachers need to do right now, August 30th?
You know, I think, so first of all, as we're wrapping up, just Tennille, thank you for the conversation tonight. Thanks for your great job moderating and collecting the questions, and everybody who's behind the scenes with Safe Schools Saskatchewan. You've been doing a great job. And thank you again to Dr. Huang, who's been doing an incredible job as an advocate and public health expert throughout this. That information is so helpful. And, you know, I want to thank you for giving me a chance to answer some of your questions. I know there's times where I just don't know, and I appreciate the patience with that. And, you know, I've tried to bring through this whole process, you know, sitting in my office where in Saskatoon, where I've done hundreds of these Zooms, press conferences and conversations, just trying to continue to lead us towards the best possible response for the health, well-being overall of Saskatchewan people. And that's gotta be our shared goal throughout all of this. And I hope that tonight's conversation helped address some of the questions that exist and help move us in the right direction. Right now, August 30th, not a lot is going to change between now and September 8th. We know the government isn't going to come forth with any new initiatives. Keep the pressure on nonetheless. Keep asking your questions, telling your story. But come September 8th, you're in a classroom, or your kids are in a classroom. That's when we really need to hear things loud and clear. How many kids are in that classroom? What are the things that just aren't making sense? How quickly are we seeing teachers having to miss work, students having to miss school, all of these things? Tell your stories loud and clear once people are in the building, as we realize, as we go through the bumps and challenges, expose the weaknesses so that we can demand change. We got an election coming October 26th, and I can commit to you this. We will not, as New Democrats, continue down the road of underfunding education. You will absolutely see from us a commitment to fund education adequately and to continue to keep up with enrollment and address the class sizes and complexity that existed before the pandemic, and to make the necessary investments to get us through this. We can't wait till October 26th. These changes have to happen now. So please stay loud, tell your stories, tell us how many kids are in class, tell us the challenges you're facing, keep the pressure on.
I love it. And we will continue to do that. And I know this group will continue speaking out and being forward, and we're not backing down. Nobody in this group has been intimidated or felt the need to be quiet thus far. So you haven't heard from the last of us. And I know we have not heard from the last of you either. Yes, yes, Dr. Huang, please don't worry.
No, you have not heard the last from me tonight. Sorry. So maybe just, I saw quite a great question earlier. And so maybe that would be a somewhat positive note to leave us on tonight.
Sure.
And the question was whether, from Roberta Kane, are there likely to be less other colds and flu-like illness with the increased use of masks? There are a number of respiratory viruses, and the main one that we get vaccinated for every year is influenza, seasonal influenza virus. And from the data that we've seen in other countries that have gone through the influenza season at the height of COVID-19, I am certain that the measures we're taking against COVID-19 will have a positive impact on influenza, meaning that what we do to prevent COVID-19 will also prevent influenza illness. So that would be one upshot. And I would suggest the saving from influenza-related illness and healthcare costs perhaps should be freed up to contribute to, you know, the measures against the control of COVID-19. So one positive thing about this fall winter, if we do things right against COVID-19.
Listen, we will take all the positives we can get. Every single one of them we will take and we will work with. Thank you so much for saying that.
Thanks for having me.
We will end the night, and thank you again, everybody who participated in this chat. I know the Safe Schools Saskatchewan will be uploading this to YouTube. I can see in the chat that they've also been sharing little tidbits from tonight on Twitter. So if you follow the Safe Schools Saskatchewan Twitter account, you can see, I'm guessing, some great quotes from Dr. Meili and Dr. Why do I want to keep saying Ryan Meili, Dr. Meili?
Ryan is just fine.
Ryan. Okay. We're on a first name basis now. This is good. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. I really, really appreciate it. And for the Safe Schools Saskatchewan group, for all the work they have done. Until next time. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Neil. Thanks, everyone. Night.